Welcome to nonstopneuron.com, where learning medical concepts is as easy as watching cartoons. In this video, we will talk about the countercurrent exchange mechanism of vasa recta in kidneys. In the medulla, the osmolarity of the interstitium increases as we go deeper and deeper. At the apex of pyramids, it can reach up to 1200 milliosmoles per liter. Now, the problem is that the osmolarity of blood plasma is only 300. So if the blood passes through this area just like that, the solutes will diffuse down this concentration gradient from the medullary interstitium into the plasma. This would wash out all the solutes and abolish the medullary hyperosmolarity. And if this happens, the ability to produce concentrated urine will be lost. Thus, routine capillaries will create a problem in this area. To prevent this, the blood supply to the medulla is of a special type. It has two special features that prevent it from washing out the medullary hyperosmolarity. One feature is the countercurrent exchange mechanism. And second is very low blood flow. First, let's talk about the countercurrent exchange. The capillaries in the medulla are called vasa recta. They form hairpin-like loops. The descending vasa recta enters from the cortex and goes deep into the medulla. Then it makes a hairpin turn and goes back to the cortex as ascending vasa recta. So we have a countercurrent system here. To understand how it is helpful, we will use this simplified diagram. Like other capillaries, the wall of the vasa recta is freely permeable to water and small solutes. So the plasma and interstitium freely equilibrate with each other at every level. Now, increasing number of solutes as we go deeper in the diagram indicates higher and higher osmolarity in the interstitium. From the perspective of water, we can show the same thing with a decreasing number of water drops. So this is the situation of the interstitium. Now come to the vasa recta. Here, blood with an osmolarity of 300 enters the descending limb. At the top, it encounters slightly increased osmolarity in the interstitium. So water starts diffusing into the interstitium. Simultaneously, the solutes start diffusing into the vasa recta. So the osmolarity of the plasma also increases. When this blood moves ahead, it encounters even higher osmolarity. So the same process of water exit and solute entry happens here also. This increases the osmolarity even further. This way, the osmolarity of plasma keeps on increasing as the blood goes deeper and deeper. At the tip, it reaches about 1200 milliosmoles per liter. Now the blood takes a turn and starts ascending. This time, the osmolarity in the interstitium is lower than that in plasma. So now, the water starts entering the capillary, and solutes start leaving it. So the osmolarity of plasma falls. In the next block, it faces further decreased osmolarity. So it again takes up water and loses the solutes. So there is a further fall in osmolarity. This continues to happen as the blood keeps ascending towards the cortex. In the end, its osmolarity is slightly more than 300. So this is what happens with each block of blood at each site. If you understood it properly, it's time to see the collective picture. Take your time and observe what's happening with water and solutes. I give you 10 seconds. Okay, now let me make it clear what I wanted you to observe. First, see the movement of solutes. From the interstitium, they enter the descending vasa recta, go to the tip, take turns, ascend, and come back to the interstitium again. Then they enter into the descending vasa recta again. Thus the solutes keep recirculating in this area. In simple words, the solutes are trapped in the deeper part of the medulla. This is also emphasized by more number of solutes at the deeper part, as compared to their lesser number, on the superficial part. Now see what's happening with the water. The water from the descending vasa recta enters the interstitium, is reabsorbed by the ascending vasa recta, and is taken to the cortex right away. Thus water is prevented from going deeper into the medulla. You can see this in the form of fewer water drops at the bottom part, as compared to their higher number in the upper part. In simple words, the water takes a shortcut by bypassing the deeper part of the vasa recta. This prevents the dilution of deeper fluid. So this is how the countercurrent exchange mechanism works. Here, the descending and ascending vasa recta are exchanging solutes and water. This is the reason why this mechanism is called countercurrent exchange. So this is one feature of vasa recta that prevents the dissipation of medullary hyperosmolarity. The next important feature is the low blood supply of the medulla. The medulla receives less than 10% of total renal blood flow. A sluggish flow minimizes the washout of solutes. So having low blood flow is an important requirement. If you are not able to understand the importance of low blood flow intuitively, let me explain it with an analogy. Think of concentration as heat. The higher the concentration, the hotter the fluid. In this analogy, the inner medulla is very hot. And the plasma is very cool. To keep the medulla hot, the volume of cool plasma flowing through it should be minimum. If the volume of blood flow is high, the heat cannot be maintained. The medulla might have a system to manage the cool fluid, but it can work only up to a limit. If the cool fluid comes in a very large quantity, the system will fail, and heat will be lost. Similarly, increased flow of relatively dilute plasma dilutes the interstitium, despite countercurrent exchange. So this is the reason why we have low blood flow in the medulla. Please note that despite being relatively low, it's sufficient to meet the metabolic needs of the tissues in the medulla. So the metabolic activities are not compromised. Now, there are a few more points worth noting. 1. The fluid coming out of ascending vasa recta has slightly more solutes and water than that entered. At a steady state, these solutes and water represent the net new reabsorption from the renal tubule. The solutes trapped to keep medulla hyperosmolar are not taken away. 2. The vasa recta does not create the osmolarity gradient. It just prevents its dissipation. The responsibility of creating this gradient is still on the countercurrent multiplier mechanism and urea recycling. And both these things are done by nephron. So this was all about countercurrent exchange. Now let's have a quick summary. Blood supply to the renal medulla comes from the vasa recta. Blood flow in descending and ascending vasa recta are in countercurrent directions. The blood going deeper loses water and takes up the solutes. Whereas the blood coming out loses solutes and takes up water. This traps the solutes in the deeper medulla and prevents water from going deeper. So inner medullary hyperosmolarity is maintained. Apart from this countercurrent exchange, the low blood flow in the vasa recta is also very important in the prevention of washing out the gradient. Now for sticking with me until the end, here is a bonus point for you. The vasa recta is formed by efferent arterioles of juxtamedullary nephrons. The arterioles from cortical nephrons make the peritubular capillary network in the cortex only. So this was all about the role of vasa recta and countercurrent exchange in maintaining corticomedullary osmolarity gradient. If you liked this video, please share it with your friends and colleagues too. And don't forget to subscribe, because lots more to come. Thanks for watching, see you in the next video.